the February 18th, 2014 regularly scheduled board meeting. Ms. Brown, is there a notification of the public?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. And there is a confirmation of a quorum. There are five members here at this moment. I'll entertain a motion to enter executive session.
Madam Chair, I make a motion that we enter executive session.
Thank you,
Mr. Second.
Thank you, Mr. Mill.
Second.
Mr. Fritz, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We will enter executive session no longer than 30 minutes. We will reconvene the public session at no later than 6:30.
Madam Chair, make a motion we exit executive session.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Frick. Mr. Miller, during the executive session session, no action was taken and legal matters were discussed. Again, welcome to the February 18th, 2014 regular call school board meeting, Fairfield County School Board of Trustees. I'm sorry. We didn't vote to get out of executive session. All those in favor, thank you. That's four. Thank you, Ms. Brown. Again, the welcome, and we'll move on to the Pledge of Allegiance.
Everybody stand. Pledge of Allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
While you're standing, take a moment of reflection. Thank you.
Thank you, and we'll move to the approval of the agenda.
Madam Chair.
Yes, ma'am.
Before you, anybody put a motion on the floor for the approval of the agenda, I would just like for the record to reflect that I sent three items, and they were all policy items to go on the agenda, and you illegally polled board regarding those agenda, those items, and chose not to put them on the agenda, and I just want to express my concern, because one was regarding travel and the fact that I was told that we're writing travel checks to the staff and to the board members for the hotel fee, and the hotel cost check should be written to the hotel. The other one was the facility usage, and that we have been allowing usage of our facility that is not in compliance with our policy. And then the third was where I received some phone calls from parents over at high school regarding how the rankings and how the salutatorian and valedictorian is calculated for students who enter into the high school. And I only wanted us to discuss those items so that the board can be clear about what the policy says and that we can follow our own policy. And I just want on the record my disappointment that you chose to illegally hold board and you chose not to put those items on the agenda. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McDaniel. In polling the board for agenda items, the majority of the board members did not want those items on the agenda, so therefore they were not placed. Any objection to the agenda? We'll move forward.
Madam Chair, just before you move on, two of the items was mentioned at the last board meeting, and without objection, those items should have gone on the agenda. And all the board members did not say they didn't want it on there. You just interpreted their statements as they're not wanting it on there.
And that would be my role. Any objections to the agenda for tonight? We'll move forward.
I also want to bring up that we have conferences. It was stated in the, on the forms, certain dates that people are going down. And we have...
That's out of order. We'll talk about that on the board traveling. We can talk about that at the board travel. Thank you. Out of order. Let's move on. Is there a motion to approve the agenda?
Madam Chair, make a motion to approve the agenda.
Thank you. Thank you. Those in favor of the agenda as posted, as public, signify by raising your right hand. We've got four opposed. Two, three. Thank you. We'll move forward.
Madam Chair, we have three people in public comment. Shall we come forward in whichever order we get called here? We have Tyler Belton, Eliza Bolware, and Mr. Thomas Armstrong.
Good evening. My name is Tyler Billy, and I'm a seventh grader from Fairfield Middle School. I'm the student that sits in the classroom, walks the halls, and goes into the...
Excuse me. Madam Chair, is the mic on?
I'm the student that sits in the classroom, walks the halls, and goes into the restroom just to get jumped on, picked on, and called rounds from boys that don't know me or either don't like me. I'm the student that has the teacher that don't respond to the students that pick on me until I respond, then I'm sent out of the class. I'm the student that had three boys jumped on me in the bathroom and reported it to the principal, never was told an outcome. I'm the boy that when a student punched me in the eye and I responded, the teacher who stood in the classroom did nothing when the boy was calling me out my name, and that student had walked from the back of the classroom to the front of the classroom and hit me. Then he said he never want me in the back in his class again. I'm that student that the principal talked at me when my mom was trying to talk to her and made me feel I was doing everything wrong. I'm the student that asked for help and can't get it from certain teachers. I'm the student that does have teachers that care, but my education is important in all my classes. I'm the student you told my mother not to believe me. I'm the student that maybe can't afford iPods or iPhones, but I still don't want to be left behind. I'm the student who had his phone stolen twice and recovered it both times. One student written his name on it. The other came back trying to sell the phone in the classroom. I'm the student that knows it's my responsibility to keep up with my stuff, but I ask, if they stole school property, will that student get in trouble? I'm a person, not just a student count. I'm the son of Eliza Bowe and Brian Belton, and I'm just as important as you, as your child and family member. I'm Tyler Belton, and I'm happy. Thank you for listening.
Good evening. I am Eliza Bowen. I am the mother of the student that just finished speaking. I come today because I have the concern. Originally, I was going to print off your policies, your statements that you have online for his code of conduct, but I felt that if you put the policies in place, you know your policy. I can't say how other students, other parents feel, but I came to say that I now am taking full responsibility of the education and the safety of my child. I have tried speaking to different people about my, what's going on with my son. I've talked with the teacher, told them that it was not one occasion, but several occasions that he has been in the bathroom with three students either have jumped on him or surrounded him and had one student to try to jump on him. I'm not sure of what your policy that you're going to follow, but I, as a parent, cannot go to work and be at work worrying about if my son's going to get jumped today, he's going to get mistreated. Long time ago, I was told that the things that I would go through would, may not be about me, but it would be about for someone else. So as I stand today, I'm speaking just on behalf of my son, but other kids or other parents that may be living in property. I know that the policy says that every student should be able to have their iPads or access to computers in the classroom, but that's not what's happening. My son should not have to take a cell phone to school to be able to look up stuff or do classwork on the cell phone. But because he has the desire not to be left behind, I allow him to take that phone to school. It's not the school responsibility for us when it was stolen, but my thing is you have a policy in place to say if you have petty theft and if a student is caught stealing, then the parent should be notified and there's a restitution. Well, I can't say about the second student, but the first student, I personally knew the parent. I called that parent to talk to him. That parent had no clue. So as I stand saying that I'm not getting phone calls to tell me what's going on with my son, that a parent does not know that their child is at school stealing from other kids, I don't think that that's right. Because when you stigmatize our children, you're saying our kids are bad, our kids are doing this, but you don't give us the opportunity to correct the things that may be going on. So I'm asking that if you would please give me a written statement back, because I know that you can't respond to me tonight, but I would love to have a written statement so that I know that you care enough, not for the kids that have money, or not just for your family, but that you care about every child in that school system. Every child deserves a good education, and every child deserves to be safe. My son gets up some mornings and cry and not want to go to school because somebody said something the day before. My son don't always talk to adults. If he has a relationship with you, he will speak and talk to you. But you have, and I think that God did this for me because sometimes you think that we're fussing and we're trying to take up for our children, but this is the proof that I finally got. On yesterday, the teacher accused him of charging his phone. He told the teacher, I didn't charge my phone. That's not my charger. He had to bring this home because that teacher refused to believe him. Every child in your school district is not a liar. Mm-hmm. They have parents that love them and parents to support them. And I feel that as my tax dollars are paying, that if my child is not going to get the education and the same rights as everybody in that school, that somewhere is failing. And if it's not going to be done here, then let me know because I will continue to go forward if I have to go all the way to Washington, D.C. to demand the right for my child to get the education. This is his future. The same way you made it to get to college, to get your education, don't hinder mine because he may not be fitting your category. I can't say why you don't do, but what I've seen is that the kids are not all treated the same and that they all don't get the same fair education or respect. Every child, regardless of their background or regardless of their behavior, treat them like they're humans. They're not your count. Just to say, we get federal dollars because we have this amount of kids that's living in poverty, but then those kids that are living in poverty are not getting the same fair education. So I ask again if I can please get a written response so I know that the board have decided we got policies, and those policies need to be effective. And if you decide, thank you.
Mr. Armstrong.
Good evening to the board and the superintendent and all the taxpayers here tonight. What I came to say, I had witnessed something at the last school board meeting. And what I'm about to say is not intended to demean or lessen anyone else's concerns, but I had already originally decided last school board meeting, this is something that I thought was worth saying. For those of you who don't know me, I had one time I attended school board meeting awards. I don't care if it was on Saturday, Sunday, whatever, I was here. Because, like the lady just spoke, I am a concerned parent also, and I'm a taxpayer. I witnessed something on last school board meeting that just shocked me. And it shocked me in a pleasant way, being that I had been commented and had been considered by some as the biggest critic of the school board. I witnessed something that really showed me that there are some improvement, that we are moving forward. There was a comment, the board meeting was going on, there was a comment that was made from the audience. Everybody laughed, and we went on with the board meeting as normal. In the past, something like that would have caused me or someone else to be put out. But it shows that there is progress in our district. It shows that we have moved from where we were, and we're moving forward. I think that as a district, we are really moving forward. It spoke a lot to the board to say that, you know, we find human those things that are laughable to enjoy that moment, but move on and handle business. It also says that, you know, in the midst of everything that's going on, let's not be fooled. While we are moving forward and the district is being highly recognized all over the place, we still have some of those who are among us that just refuse to let go. That if I'm not in control, I'm going to do whatever I can to hinder the progress. And I say to the board, thank you for all that you do, for volunteering your time, and please don't allow those few who sit among us to destroy what we're doing, because we're really moving forward. And I'm very pleased with the direction in which we're going. Now, I'm only one parent. Now, I realize we don't have a perfect system, but if we keep working at it and punching at it, we're going to make it a lot better. Thank you.
That's all about Kelly.
Presentations and recognitions.
We have the Fairfield Middle School chorus that is going to be presenting a medley of things today. And if you've not had the pleasure of seeing them, then you are in for a treat. I'll tell you that I had my first opportunity to see them this year doing, I guess it was there. I don't know what the performance was. It was Christmas concert, that's what it was. It was Kirkpatrick over the Christmas. It was doing the Christmas concert. And I can tell you, I left thoroughly impressed. So just sit back and relax. You're in for a free treat. They must be out here practicing. Well, Brian, why don't you go ahead and play that? You want to have that ready? Oh, you already played?
Yes.
Okay, that's all right. The chorus is under the direction of Ms. Graham, who is the chorus teacher at Fairfield Middle School.
The principal of Fairfield Middle School, and the entire Fairfield Middle School chorus, I would like to thank Superintendent Green and the Board of Trustees for the invitation to perform for you this evening. We are indeed ecstatic to be here with you tonight. I would like to personally thank, I call them the Fantastic Four, Mr. Boyd, Ms. Green, and Mr. Gillespie, who helps me all the time with my children, a part of the Related Arts team at Fairfield Middle School. Tonight, the Fairfield Middle School Chorus will perform two selections for your hearing. The first selection will be I Dreamed a Dream from Les Miserables with Thomas Few, an eighth grader, as soloist, and Ms. Christy Lewis, lead orchestra teacher in Richard School District 1 on violin. The second selection will be a spiritual entitled Thy Done Made My Bow to the Lord by Nolan Williams. We thank you again for coming tonight, and we hope that you enjoy the performance.
Thank you very much to the chorus, the teachers, and the parents for bringing them, being responsible for their talent and behavior getting here tonight. We appreciate all the efforts involved in that. It was certainly delightful, and we enjoyed it very much. Thanks again. Next, we'll have the fire service presentation.
We got back about a few months ago. I got with Mr. Green and Chris from the Career Center, and we talked about this, get the fire program into the school system. We've been talking about it for 3 years in fire service now, at least 3 years. And it's, the state has got a good program now that I think y'all will like. It's come through the education system and all that stuff. And what we're going to do, Mr. Brian Reedy, the recruitment and retention coordinator for the South Carolina Firefighters Association, is here to explain the whole system, how it works, how we get it into the school system, and all that stuff. And I don't know if it's possible to get into the school system this coming year, but at least a bare minimum, if y'all accept it, to get it into the new Career Center in 2015, or whenever it was, you know, at least 2015. I will have Mr. Brian Reedy come up and explain the
Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity this evening. My name is Brian Reedy, as Tony Hill has already introduced me this evening. I do serve as the Recruitment Retention Grant Coordinator for the South Carolina State Firefighters Association. It is a member benefit association established in the state in 1905, so we're over 100 years old, providing member benefits back to the member agencies within the state of South Carolina. I appreciate this opportunity, Madam Chair, Mr. Superintendent, and other members of the board to explain this program. I know you're very well aware of federal grants. Our association applied for and received a Department of Homeland Security grant in 2012 to impact volunteerism in the state of South Carolina. South Carolina is not unique in its setting. Across the nation, nearly 80% of fire protection is provided by volunteer agencies and volunteer firefighters. We track about those same numbers in the state of South Carolina. We may be just a little shy, and that's part of the reason the grant was submitted, was to help develop avenues for us to gain more volunteer firefighters throughout the state. 46 counties throughout the state, there is not a career center in every county within the state, but it's been a cooperative effort between the Department of Education, the South Carolina Fire Academy, and the State Firefighters Association. When the grant was received, it happened, and I know when I speak of bureaucracy, you know how slow the wheels can turn from time to time. When the grant was received, there was a transition period in the training programs, fire service training programs throughout the nation, between one essentials manual and the next. So the content portion of that, we had to stave off making the content portion of the curriculum play out. It is still being written as I speak today, but to that end, the association hired a curriculum writer, actually two curriculum writers that both have career technology center backgrounds. One lives in Oklahoma, the other lives in Colorado. We contracted with them to develop what we refer to as our South Carolina Firefighter 1 and 2 instructor guide and student workbook for high schools and career technology centers. This is a copy hot off the press from the South Carolina Fire Academy. Got our own little logo here showing, as I stated before, the Department of Education, the Fire Academy, and the association. As we traveled around the state talking at the time, Dr. Rod Miller, some of you may recall Dr. Miller, served
as the emergency services cluster coordinator. He was responsible for the fire and EMS side of it. He was on board. He changed jobs. Ms. Susan Flanagan and BT Martin are taking up the charge behind Dr. Miller. This work, the curriculum writer has developed this and has modularized it. The intent of this program would be to take students who are 16 and 17 years old, male or female, put them in a career program, and at the end of their two-year period, they would walk out with a certification level firefighter 2, which is necessary in most areas for full-time employment. It's not particularly necessary for volunteers, but it is the best training that they could receive. You say, well, how may that happen? Well, state law allows 16 and 17-year-olds to receive this instruction. It's known as the Junior Firefighter Program, but for that to occur, it would require and does require the involvement of the local fire service, because they must be members of a career technology center. They must also be junior members or explorers. The scouting program and the junior firefighter programs both meet the intent of the South Carolina state law. It requires those folks to be involved because, as most career centers, I know all school boards face the needs. You don't have monies to spend for equipment. They're going to be able to supply ladders, hose, and things like that when it comes to training days. But the curriculum developers broke all of the content material. They took, at that point in time, they took the current Department of Education guidance for fire and emergency services, and that curriculum writer crosswalked this document into this one. These standards, the Firefighter 1 and 2, meet the National Fire Protection Association standards for firefighters throughout the nation. Curriculum writer then also took all of the standards, because we know some schools may have different textbooks that they would want to use. She provided another crosswalk for other textbooks. So we feel like we've got a very good package here. I will say that the desire is to get this in as many career centers as we can throughout the state. At this point in time, there are some programs already in play for 2014. We'll be piloting this program because it is a new program and it needs to be in the field, needs to be piloted for a while. As you all are aware, you put a document together, you're sure to find some problems, some hiccups along the way, but she modularized it all so that, depending on how your students, if they go to the career center for a three-hour time period one time a week, your course instructor can take this, could develop his lesson plans, utilize it. Once a program is in play, the total cost to the student would be $5. They will get this manual. They will get complete access for that $5 to the South Carolina State Fire Academy's online learning resource center. So if you've got the computer labs, it would give them an additional resource. So low cost. They would also all receive a copy of the most recent Essential 6 volume, which is the fire service training manual that would be a companion document to this. So we would encourage you to consider it, work with your local fire service leaders. As I said, at this point, 2014 will be a pilot year. We hope to roll it out. And the intent is, after this is in play across the state of South Carolina, that we start developing and putting more volunteer firefighters into the field. Are there any questions? I'll be happy to entertain them if you ask them. Yes, sir.
The equipment will be provided by the fire service?
That is the intent, because we understand most school districts, most career centers will not have access to a pump room, would not have ladders, would not have nozzles, would not have the kind of things that they would be that would be needed to train that student. In that regard, to the extent that the student would be receiving the training portion, okay, any equipment, whether it met current standards for compliance, in my field, I spent 33 years in the fire service, I can train you with an air pack. Now, when I get ready to put you in a burn building, I would have to have you in a fully compliant air pack. So, we're starting an effort at the association level that would utilize spare equipment throughout the state, hand off, let the career center directors have access to that. We're working on future grants that potentially would satisfy the requirement of bringing training equipment the day of the practice burn or their testing burn, so they would have fully compliant equipment that day.
Next question.
Yes, sir.
The cost for a 1,000 GPM pump, basically what, $150,000 to $200,000?
On the rural side, if it was a rural spec pumper, yes, sir. And that's on the low side. If you went fully custom cab, you could spend over $300,000.
Okay, that would be an expense. Should this project go forward, the school district would not have to go.
That is our intent. They would not have to engage themselves and have that type of equipment.
What do you mean, Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Yeah. What do you mean by pump? Tell me what you're talking about, because I don't know fire.
That's fair enough. Yes, sir. Fire engine. A fire engine. Yes, sir.
All right. To answer Cunningham's question a little bit, I've already talked with the county council. We will provide a pumper, hose, axes, and stuff. I'm fully equipped fire cook for this class. I've already talked to them about doing that. We usually get a brand new fire truck each year. We try to anyway. And the one I'm taking out of service, we don't take them out of service. I'm taking one out of service as a replacement, and that one will be stay in the county, fully equipped for this program.
Thank you.
I know she, and thank you, Tony, for clarifying. You kept using the word intent, as though we might provide it, but there may be a chance that
we won't. Provide a fire truck.
But if the grant doesn't pay for it, then the county is going to provide all of the, everything that the school district need.
That's where we've got to, everybody's got to meet together. I've already had permission from the county council to provide fire truck for this program.
So would there be any calls for the school district that you're aware of?
There's no call for a truck. Until y'all get a place to house a truck, we'll have to keep it and bring it to school the day they need it. But it's just if you get a new building built and build a place to house this fire truck, it'll stay at schoolhouse. Okay. It'll be y'all. It will be, we'll stay there.
Okay, and how long is the course going to be?
It's designed to be a 2-year program, ma'am.
For total completion, and how does that equate, or how is that relative to credits for the students that sign up for it?
All right, that's an education issue on the educational side of it. To that end, I don't have an answer for that. I don't know how the local school board would treat the course. Not being from a career technology center background, I'm not sure how courses of that nature are handled for grades.
Madam Chair, Mr. Green, have any one of you guys looked into how that would?
Yes, ma'am. We could design the course where it is a one Carnegie unit credit. So we could have it designed a potentially a full-year course or a semester course in a 4x4 schedule. And students would receive one Carnegie unit.
Okay. And are we expected to vote on this tonight or just for information? So where would it start? Would vote before it starts that we're going to add to our program?
So I guess he's great to present to the board in terms of programmatic type concerns like that. Those are things that generally wouldn't come before the board to vote on as we think about what programs will be offered at the new career center.
But with the board consensus, not official promotion, we would be able to move on.
With what I'm saying?
If the majority of the board at the present time would feel, I don't know if it's going to be legal or illegal, but the majority of the board is this a program we want to move forward with, as far as I'm concerned, yes.
I think we need to get the recommendation on the table and come back in a little bit more formal way on that. The information is good. The one question I have is I keep hearing, I think Ms. McDaniel probably is kind of leaning that way too. I hear the truck, the hoses, all that. What other equipment would there be an obligation for the school district to provide?
Yeah.
And I'm not necessarily sure what equipment would be necessary, but I am to assume that just like any other course, there would be some equipment that a school district would have to purchase. No different than a masonry class, an electricity class, or any other class. So there will be costs that the district would have to absorb as with any program.
I just didn't want there to be any confusion at all. So there could be some investment, which there usually should be. I totally agree. I just want to make sure we're not stepping out saying we're going to do all this.
Madam Chair, I have one more question. Tony, y'all were talking about the fire, but would EMS be, are we involved in, would that be something that y'all be looking at? I know someone mentioned it.
She's totally different program than the medical side of it. Okay. We're just the fire side of it. Now, if y'all want to put a medical program in the school at a later date, you know, you can do that. Also, that could also be a career for the guy.
I just thought there was something to say about
for a job.
Madam Chair, if I may, two things. I use the word intent because my position. I cannot come into a school district and I cannot force the fire service to accept either one of these. We've tried to help develop a curriculum that could be utilized. And I am the one that mentioned the EMS side of it. The Department of Education public safety or public service cluster includes police, fire, and EMS. And I did use those words, yes.
Madam Chair, one final question. Will there be a certification for the students once they finish the program into what extent is it recognized? Is it national or?
Yes, ma'am. The curriculum would provide national level certification at Firefighter 2, which is a job requirement in most communities. So this makes your student successfully completing this program job ready.
Okay. Now, Tony, are we going to start paying our firemen? Because I know we're going to volunteer. We're going to start paying.
That's not there. Don't help the county council with high firemen.
Ms. Harper has a question, then we can move on. Thank you.
What is this in comparison to? Don't they have some program now that they're doing in some of the stations? I was thinking Ridgeway had one. I was thinking some of Winsboro had something.
Yes, ma'am. There are programs throughout the state right now that have been just staying with the current Department of Education program. What we learned is early on, there was so much variance in those programs, they were not all providing a certification level endpoint, and that's been our desire. And we know that on the educational side, school boards and districts looking for dollars, federal dollars to help keep things funded. On the Perkins side, some of the job-ready requirements will be coming down the pike, and we've attempted to get out in front of that and be able to provide a package that can be utilized by local school boards.
So with this being done by the county, are you trying to, you said something about doing that in 2014, is that what you're trying to get into the county right now as far as their different departments?
Well, that would be a concern that the fire service and the school board would have to deal with. We've got some agencies that would be piloting this program for us right now. We have a young student, an instructor in the Anderson District 1 and 2, Luke Riddle, who essentially, this has been his program, and he's been utilizing this. It's not uncommon for him to have 100 students waiting to get into his program. He's very engaged with the students, and he's turning out volunteer firefighters in the Anderson County area.
How many counties have the program already? It's quite a few.
A total number of, and what Tony asked was how many school or career centers currently utilize a fire program. I believe at last count I had 13 programs that I was aware of. Now that may have increased, and there may be folks that are teaching it and we're just not aware of it. It's not been uncommon for, and with no disrespect, maybe a school director or principal come and tell the welding shop instructor that he was going to teach fire the next year. Now that's off the wall analogy, but that individual had no real knowledge and might have done a Google search and found some fire-related materials and taught part of the school year on fire service. And he was just doing it to satisfy the local need.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
One quick question. Isn't it true that y'all have a high-ranking official in your organization that is actually a product of the Fairfield County School District?
I believe so, sir. I'd be happy to introduce the Assistant Director of the South Carolina State Firefighters Association, Mr. Jason Pope is here with me this evening. Yes, sir.
Just want to recognize Mr. Pope, who sat beside me in physics and English.
Mr. Pope grew up in our volunteer system, out of 11. And I want to say one thing, that I'm familiar with this program through Westwood, because my brother-in-law teaches it. And he had 6 students last year. That was the first year they had it. They kind of put it in the system real quick. This year, he's full class, waiting room only to get into this system. Westwood, the second year, is waiting room only.
All right, thank y'all. Thank you very much.
And we do have some juniors out here. There's 5 or 6 of them out there right now that's in high school now that can get into this program.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank y'all for coming. Yeah. Appreciate your attendance. We'll move on to the minutes. The recommendation is that the board approve the minutes from the January 21st regular call meeting. I'll entertain that motion.
I'm sorry, what did you say, Madam Chair?
Approving the minutes from the January 21st meeting.
At the next meeting?
Right now.
Can we wait? There's some statements that I said that doesn't look too correct, and I can engage you guys to allow me to look back at these and approve them at the next meeting. I would greatly appreciate it.
Let's approve them with your changes to be come later. How about that?
Well, what happens is when we do that, then the changes still doesn't get done. So then now I can see him go through the things that I did pick up.
Well, I'm going to do that afterwards with Ms. Brown, and we'll approve them as y'all do the changes, and y'all do the changes tonight.
I'm not going to have time to do that now.
Write them, email them to
her. I guess it's the pleasure of the board, but when we approve minutes and we rushing through stuff, Madam Chair, it's just not good. These are our only official legal document, and we don't make sure that they are correct when we vote on them, and we vote on them just to rush through. That's not good. We're not going to be on this board forever, and when someone go back and research our minutes, they need to be as accurate as possible.
That motion by Mr. Cunningham.
Made a motion, and I agree with Ms. McDaniels. Anything just have Steve try to get second.
I'm second.
What's the motion on?
I'm not sure what the motion on the floor is. Mr. Cunningham made the motion to approve the minutes. Mr. Miller?
I second it, but I was just saying what Ms. McDaniel was saying, that any corrections?
You're amending your motion to that. Mr. Cunningham amended
his motion. And I second it.
Okay, so state that motion, or let me restate that. You will recommend approval of the minutes with those corrections.
I'm not going to accept that, Madam Chair. Even though I didn't make the motion, I understand I may be out of order, but that means I'm in isolation going to go through and mention the corrections. And if everybody else sit up here and tell me y'all read these minutes and y'all don't see any errors in them, something is wrong.
I've read the minutes, so we'll go ahead. And we've got a motion and a second on the floor. All those in favor of approving the minutes, signify by raising every right hand. We've got 4 opposed, 3.
And Madam Chair, I'm gonna let them go. If the majority of you guys think they're okay and y'all obviously didn't read them carefully, then we're just gonna let them go rip it like that.
Superintendent's report.
Madam Chair, first of all, I'd like to recognize the Fairfield Central High School robotics team. These young folks have been working very, very hard. A robotics competition, I think, will occur maybe the 27th of October. I had an opportunity to go over to the high school today and actually see the robot in action. It is a very intense competition. They'll be competing with students all over the state of South Carolina. This will be our first year competing. I'd like to thank those parents who have really poured a lot of energy and time into assisting our young people. We had some assistance from some of the engineers at the Scanlon Nuclear Facility. It was truly a team effort. So let's continue to wish them well. I think today is the last day that the robot can be modified. They have to tag it and bag it, as they say. And they can't really make any modifications until they arrive at the competition. So we'd like to once again recognize them. Also, please take a look at the newsletter. As always, Ms. Wallace has done an excellent job putting together an outstanding newsletter and continues that in a very informative website. The next on the list, you had an opportunity to witness the Fairfield Middle School chorus. And as I said before, they performed an absolutely outstanding group of young people. Last year, I think, was the first year they attended the Disney Sings Youth Performance edition down in Orlando, Florida. They have been raising money all year long to return. And first of all, you have to be invited to attend this performance. And because we were so impressive last year, we were invited once again. The total cost of the trip is right at $20,000. They have donations and fundraisers and contributions somewhere in the range of approaching $10,000. And I have worked with Mr. Robinson to identify some savings in the budget, and I am making a recommendation that the board supplement the Fairfield Middle School chorus trip for half of that amount, which is $10,000.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation.
I second that.
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham. Mr. Miller, any questions or discussion?
Madam Chair.
Yes, ma'am.
How do we make the decision as it relates to the organization's or initiatives or whatever the word is that we're going to fund?
I can answer that, Madam Chair. Ms. McDaniel, I mean, I think everyone in the district personnel understand that if you have funding requests, and you can present that to me, I'll review that request and determine whether it warrants a recommendation to the board.
Madam Chair, from a policy standpoint, what do we have in place regarding, because I thought it was another group that was trying to raise money to take a trip. And I know, so I'm asking from a policy standpoint, how do we make sure that there's equity and fairness in paying for our students to take trips to the state? And it's
asking. In terms of a policy, Ms. McDaniel, I don't see a policy that would dictate that. I mean, I think you have to evaluate each situation on its own merit. What I will tell you is, one thing that I look at very strongly as it relates to making a recommendation is how much fundraising, how much contribution have the organizations made. And so from my own personal perspective, when I see a student group that has gone out and done the fundraising efforts to try and raise the money, then I think it would be very appropriate for the district to try and match their efforts.
So do we know how much they raised?
They're approaching 10,000. They said that they'll be at 10,000 before it's all said and done. I'm not sure whether they're there yet. So our contributions, if you so vote, will fund half of those expenses. In terms of other organizations, I'll tell you that there are some other organizations that will be presenting to me sometimes in the near future. They have the same understanding, which is that I want to ensure that students have put in a little sweat equity, if you will, to try and help fund the cost of those particular ventures. A little hard work is bad, Ms. McDaniel, and so I like the fact that students are willing to go out and work hard and raise money and make some contributions and not necessarily wait on the district to fund the entire project.
And anybody in this district that knows me know that I'm the first one to say that our children need to go off and that they need to be exposed. But by the same token, I want to make sure that we're fair and equitable in what we do, and that's why I raised the question. And my final question is, where is this funding going to come from? What in the budget?
Well, I've identified several different sources, Mr. Daniel. I've identified several different sources that we can pull it from. We have some general fund money, we have some personnel savings that we could use. So we have a few options, and they're frugal with the taxpayers' money thus far this year.
Madam Chair, can Mr. Green provide us with a line item in the budget where the funding is going to come from? Well, you don't have to do it now, you can do it later.
We're going to vote on the recommendation. Ms. Hartman?
Madam Chair.
How many students are you talking about? Is there more appointment?
I'm asking later if he could just let us know what funding source in the budget that the money's coming from. I want to make sure I understood you that he's going to provide it to us.
Sure.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Ms. Hartman?
Off the top of my head, I did have it written down. Let me give you one second, Jim.
There it is, right? It's all of those right there?
I think it's close to about 40 students. And I don't know if everyone was present today. I think it'd be close to 35 or 40 students.
Thank you. Any further questions or discussion? Hearing none, we have a motion and a second to approve the funding in the amount of $10,000 for the middle school chorus to participate in Disney Sings Young Performers Edition in Florida. All those in favor signify by the raising of the right hand. Like seven there, Brown. Thank you.
Chairman Reed, members of the board, the next item on the agenda relates to the Fairfield Central High School drama program. They also have a field trip that I think they have attended for the last one or two years also, where they go and actually get to witness some performances on Broadway. And I think they actually get to perform also while they're there. And they too have been out securing donations and raising monies and making contributions. And the total cost of their trip is right at $24,000. I am making a recommendation to the board that we help supplement the dramas program trips in New York also for half of that amount, which would be $12,000.
Madam Chair, I make a motion to
accept the recommendation.
Second. Thank you, Mr. Cunningham. Mr. Miller, any discussions or questions?
How many students?
I think they have right at 30, 20. Okay,
20. 20 students.
20 students.
Now, I'm trying to just like asking people that would then just come to us if we could just know where the funding is coming from at the time that the recommendation is presented to us.
All right.
Thank you.
We'll go ahead on the vote. All those in favor of approving the superintendent's recommendation to fund the $12,000 for the Fairfield Central High School Drama Department trip to New York, signify by raising the right hand. We've got seven there. You may have seven chaperones that would be willing as well. Curriculum and instruction.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board, Superintendent Green. Tonight we are bringing forth to you the second and final reading for the board policy and administrative rule JAAB and JAAB-R, which is the service animal policy. No changes were made since the first reading of this policy, and the public meeting was held, or public hearing for this policy was held on February the 6th at 6 o'clock in room 605.
Madam Chair.
Go ahead. Yes.
I make a motion that we accept the superintendent recommendation for administration rule JAAB, JAAB-R. Right, need a second.
Second.
Thank you. Mr. Miller has made the motion. Mr. Britt seconded. Questions and discussion. Go ahead, Ms. Harris.
I just have a quick question. If the board or the notification of the public reading. When was that sent out?
I can tell you, Ms. Harrison, that the public, the announcement was placed in the newspaper. I would have to defer to either Ms. Wallace or Ms. Brown for the exact date, but I can tell you the meeting itself was indeed posted, and the announcement was posted in the local newspaper.
Any other questions or discussion? We have an appropriate motion and second to approve the second and final reading of the board policy administrative rule JAAB and JAABR, service animals. All those in favor signify by the raising of the right hand. Thank you. That appears seven. Ms. Brown. And next.
The next policy, second, is for the second and final reading of board policy IJOA field trips and administrative IJOA-R. There were no changes made to the administrative rule. However, in response to a request from a board member, it was indeed we added the day to indicate day trips. The superintendent or his or her designee would have the discretion to approve all in-state field trips and day trips to South Carolina, North Carolina, and Georgia. In addition to that, the attorney, the district attorney, was in fact consulted as relates to whether or not there were any legal barriers regarding field trips, and if in fact those barriers needed to be included in the policy. And after consulting with their attorney, there is no legal barriers as it relates to traveling out of district or out of state. So we present this administrative rule, IJOA-R, and IJOA field trip policy for second and final reading.
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham, for the motion.
I second.
Mr. Miller for the second. Is there discussion or question?
Madam Chair, can you repeat the motion, please?
The superintendent recommends the board approve the second and final reading revisions to board policy IJOA and administrative rule IJOA-R, comma, field trips.
And I think, I'm not thinking it, but Madam Chair, I was the one who expressed the concern about our students going across state lines and the board not approving it. And if I'm hearing correctly, the attorney sees nothing wrong with the students going across state lines and the board not approving it.
That's the way I heard, Ms. Dr. Edwards. So.
Is that correct, Mr. Attorney?
That's right. We looked into it. We didn't see any legal provision that would require you to approve it as across state lines. That's correct.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any further discussion or question? All those in favor signify by raising of the right hand. We've got four. Opposition? Three.
And Madam Chair,
motion passes.
I want the record to reflect that I remove myself from any kind of immunity. I mean, I accept immunity for any situation that might occur with our students going across state lines, when we know that exemptions and laws that we have in South Carolina may not apply when our students leave. And I just want to make sure that I'm on record noting my concern that we're approving a policy that our students can leave the state and the board not approve. Thank you.
Finance report.
Madam Chair, board members, and superintendent, in your board packet, you have the finance report for the month of January. And in your packet, the first schedule, which contains the financial statements and the revenue schedules, does not have the actual local tax revenue for the month of January just due to the weather last week. However, we did get that information today from the county, and that was included in a report that was sent out by the superintendent via email this afternoon. So that information is here for your review.
What is that in reference to?
Not all of the income was documented because of the weather delays last week, so another document was sent to us through email today that updated the statement.
It's not in Google Docs?
It will be. It just was sent today for information.
What time?
I don't remember getting it.
Did I repeat that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I took it. I'd like to,
Madam Chair, but what time was the email sent?
I don't know.
Probably Mr. McDaniel,
Around two or three.
I'm not sure the exact time.
I don't recall seeing that.
Nevertheless, that will be placed in board docs. I'd like to make a point on, page 27 of the 36-page, budget report by location, that the legal fees that were budgeted for the 13-14 school year are $282,000, and of that amount, we've spent, I think the update is about 40. So, just to say that we are doing a good job keeping those legal fees down, which ultimately results in more money for instruction, more money for our fund balance, and it goes back to the children, and most importantly. So I'd like to note that. Thank you.
How much did you say that
was? We've spent about $40,000 out of the budgeted $282,707 amount. Yeah, it's on page 27 of that by location document.
And by that same token, Madam Chair, sometimes we get what we pay for. And I'm going to gate and indulge that we make sure that we look at what we discuss in executive session. When we discuss some stuff in executive session, we should not. And the attorney is allowing us to do it. Thank you, ma'am.
We'll move on to the construction selection method. We just want to go with the recommendation there?
Yes. In your board packet, you have a recommendation from the superintendent that the board approve the construction selection method for the new Career and Technology Center.
And that construction selection method is the CM at risk model.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
What is the difference in this process and when we first put the bid out for the high school and MBCon submitted a, I can't remember what it was, or whatever the correct terminology, but whatever they submitted, we thought it was not, it was non-responsive to the proposal. So what is the difference in the CM at risk? I think it was builder's risk or something like that. I can't remember what it was.
I think, yeah, I think the initial RFP was for architectural services.
Right. That's correct.
Yeah.
It was design build that was proposed by that proposer. When you were seeking a different, you were asking for something else.
My question is, what's the difference between the design build and the CM risk?
Would you like me to?
The quick version.
Okay. The quick version is in design build, a single entity is retained to do both the designing and the building. It requires a lot of extra work on the part of the owner, lay out all your needs and everything before you retain someone to do that. A construction manager at risk is you've already put the team in, you've already got the architects in place. So the design part is being done by NBAJ and Brownstone. The design's about ready, and now it's time to get the person who's going to build it. So, you have two entities.
So the person who's coming in, should we hire this individual actually behind the eight ball because they're working from the design and everything that was already put in place, and they didn't have an opportunity to review any of that pre-design work?
Well, we voted on an architectural firm. So that's what we have. It is what it is. It's what we have now. So we've got to decide now on the construction method.
I understand, but I'm trying to make sure that I totally understand. So my question is related. My specific question was that when we hire this person, that because we've already hired an architect, they will be behind the eight ball because the design has already been approved and they've already moved forward.
Yeah.
Would you like me to address very briefly a you retain them as early as you want, and part of their job is to scrub those constructed documents and make recommendations before they go to build it. So that's what you do get with a construction manager at risk. Many buildings are done with sealed bids where the contractor and architect never even speak to each other until the contractor's already on the job building, whatever's in the design. So it's sort of an intermediate way of doing it. It's not a single entity, but you will have the advantage of someone who will go through those documents before they commit to price at which they'll build them. And they'll make, their contract will require them to make recommendations and scrub it for obvious errors and that kind of
thing. I guess my question is it wouldn't be unusual for us to require that this person go back and make sure that they reviewed everything that already that has already happened, even though we're just not hiring them?
Say review your architecture?
Mm-hmm. Right, and that was what he said, that they would get together in this intermediate period and scrub the design that had been.
Anyone who's going to build a building will go through the plans and specifications before they start building it and put a price on it. But, what happens if you have a bidding situation is that if they find anything advantageous in there, they may sit on it and wait to bring it up after they've got the price so they can ask for change orders. You're hoping to avoid change orders by having them do the review before they commit to go do it.
So are we going to have to pay additional to the architect because now they're going to have to go back and bring whoever's person in up to par?
I don't believe so. I think the consultation in this pre-construction phase is part of their agreement with you. So it's been contemplated that this phase would take place.
But that'd be in the contract that we have with them?
Yes, I believe it is, yeah.
Okay, if you had a question for Keith. Not for Keith, I just wanted to verify. So Brownstone will be providing the construction management.
Brownstone will be provided with the building. Brownstone is under the architectural firm.
Now, MBAJ is the architectural firm.
Well,
Brownstone. MBAJ Brownstone.
The same thing.
And I guess that's what I want to clarify. So is this board going to have the opportunity to select a construction manager? I know construction management at risk is the procedure of how the building will be put together. Will we have the opportunity to actually select a construction manager to oversee that construction, I guess is what I'm asking, given all of the prior discussion that we've had before.
In terms of the construction manager position, Ms. Harrison, that position has already been advertised. We've already held interviews with that position, and as you know, that is a classified position. So I'll be bringing a name back to the board in terms of who has been offered the position. So that is not something that will come to the board.
So the person is paid by the hour?
No.
That's the classified position?
It's a classified position in non-certified. So we're
going to actually retain the person? It's not going to be like a temporary position, or it's going to be a permanent position with the district?
It's going to be a permanent position that will be renewed on a year-to-year basis as any other position.
When did you make that decision?
That was in the budget this year. The budget for this year included a project manager. We discussed that as one of the additions to the budget when we went through the budget process.
All right, let's go ahead with the motion before we do more discussion.
I apologize. I just simply want to make a statement for the record. We'd already discussed this, and maybe it was a misunderstanding on my part. I thought we were informed at the board retreat that we would have the opportunity to choose the construction manager. So I just want to make a statement for the record so that the public understands that authority was taken out of the hands of the board and that person will be a district employee, not a contracted worker, selected by the board to oversee the funds of this project.
Superintendent recommends that the board approve the construction selection method of CM at risk for the new Career and Technology Center. Is there a motion?
Madam Chair, I have a motion to accept Superintendent's recommendation.
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham.
I second.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Now, is there further discussion or question?
Madam Chair, since it seems like so many things have just been tossed in this, can you explain one more time? Now, what's the difference? Okay, because I thought the construction manager was going to be hired by the board to oversee the project, but if we hiring a project manager who's going to be on staff here at the district under the superintendent's control. Then what again, why are we doing the CM at risk?
This is a method in which the contractor will actually be able to use local vendors to come in to do some of these projects rather than having to send it out in a large bid situation where we would have to take the high bid and we would have one general contractor. This is just a method in which the local vendors can actually get an avenue to get some of the jobs that will be created in building the Career Technology Center.
And who will be making that decision?
What decision?
The construction, the contractor. The contractor.
Madam Chair, I can provide maybe a little clarification. The construction management at risk is simply the model that you are voting on.
I understand that. Okay. But my question, though, is when they go out to put the, however we're going to put the information out that we need persons to provide these services,
okay,
who's going to make the selection of which vendor is going to provide the services?
The construction manager. So, I mean, we are hiring a firm.
The person that we hire, that's who we work for the district.
Yeah. No. The firm that we are hiring to build the building.
Okay, so what's the project manager going to do?
The project manager is going to watch out for our interests as a district. So they're going to supervise the process. So in other words, you have, let's say you hired, you pick firm XYZ. So firm XYZ is in the process of building a career center. Now, it is advantageous for us to have someone who is primarily looking out for our interests to ensure that firm XYZ is doing things in accordance with our wishes.
And we hired somebody on staff to do that. So what are they going to be doing when the project is over?
Well, when the project is over, then we'll elect to determine whether we want to keep that person on staff or not.
So
renew
what
do
you want?
I didn't realize I was. Yes, you are. Maybe I'm just loud. I don't know. But then I guess at that point, we'll determine rather we want to keep that person on staff, Mr. Daniel, or rather we want to end our relationship.
And Ms. Green, I'm apologizing, but not apologizing for asking questions.
No, I'm
but
not.
if when we have the board meetings, if we would discuss a lot of stuff in the board room at the board meeting, then I wouldn't have to be asking all these questions to make sure I understand. So, okay?
You can ask me anything, Mr. Daniel.
So
I love talking.
I know that.
Ms. Hartman.
So basically, as far as the person that we have hired and what we're fixing to possibly approve, you're going to have one overseeing the other one for part of it. But they're going to be hiring the person, but as far as overseeing, we have an extra person doing it. Is that correct?
And I don't want to necessarily say I'm an extra person, Ms. Hoffman. I think the best way to look at it is from this perspective. You hire someone to build the building. So their interest is the building, I guess, least amount of time, the least amount of cost. I mean, so they have their interest. We have someone on our staff who's watching them to watch our interests. But you follow what I'm saying? So it's not necessarily hiring an extra person per se, but it's just like, you know, if you were building a house and you had the latitude of hiring someone to watch the contractors and make sure that you didn't try and cut any corners. Okay, so you make sure you're getting exactly what you want. So we felt that it was definitely in our interest to make sure we had someone who's solely watching out for the interests of the student. Because if you hire a firm, the reality is that firm is not necessarily watching out for the interests of the district.
Exactly.
Okay, now I'm not saying that the firm is not an honest and reputable firm, but the reality is their primary interest is not the same as someone who's watching out for our primary interest.
And Madam Chair, just to caution, when we built this district office, we had the same concept in mind. And there's things still in this district office that didn't get fixed. And when that punch list went through, the person or whoever that we had overseeing still didn't. So Ms. Green, just try to make sure that we get somebody who's really qualified and know what they're looking at.
Always.
Sure you do.
All right, we'll move forward then with the vote. All those in favor of the superintendent's recommendation to the board to approve the construction selection method of CM at risk for the new Career Technology Center, please signify by raising up the right hand. We've got 5 opposed, abstention. 5-1-1. We'll move to human resources. Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board. For your approval this evening, our human resources, item 1, certified resignations and terminations.
Madam Chair, make a motion that we accept the superintendent's recommendation.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Thank you, Mr. Frick. Motion has been made that the board approve the certified resignation termination for this current school year, signified by the raising of your right hand if you agree. Got five. Opposition? You erased it. Okay, let's do it again.
Yeah.
All those in favor signify by raising of the right hand.
Did you have a question on that before vote?
We can't discuss personnel. I've read the motion and we.
Can you read it again?
Approve the certified resignation. Those in favor signify by raising of the right hand. Okay, we've got six. Opposition? One. Thank you.
And now, Madam Chair, for the future, when do we ask questions if we have questions on personnel?
I think what we should do, Madam Chair, is if you have any questions about personnel, that's something we should address in executive session.
Executive session prior to the meeting.
So in the future, I'll be sure that we cover that in executive session and we get all the questions answered.
I appreciate it.
Item two, certified recommendations.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Miller.
Make a motion that we accept the superintendent's recommendation. Right to the second.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Frick. Motion and second have been made. All those in favor of the superintendent's recommendation to approve the certified recommendation, please signify by the raising of the right hand. And it looks like seven. Thank you.
And item three, the second and final reading of the revisions to board policy GCOA and administrative rule GCOA-R, evaluation of instructional staff. Since first reading, no changes or revisions have been made, so I present this to you as it was presented last month. Also, the public hearing for this particular policy was conducted on the same evening that was stated earlier by Dr. Edwards.
Madam Chair?
Yes, sir.
Just what she said.
All right.
You know what she said.
Mr. Miller has made the motion.
Oh, my goodness.
You an attorney, you know that don't work.
Mr. Miller has made the motion.
GCOA and GCOA-R. And no, that's it.
Yep.
That's it.
Thank you. Mr. Miller has made the motion. Is there a second?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Frick. Any questions or discussion?
Can they quickly just state what those are for the audience, please, ma'am?
Yeah, what I talked about.
Go ahead.
Are you speaking of the revisions, ma'am?
No. You just want to kind of summarize the motion.
Summarize the changes.
Oh, the policy, GCOA, the evaluation of instructional staff. If you look at the second document, if you haven't looked at it, if you have not, I'm going to go through it. The first change is just changing the cycle for evaluations, changing that from a three-year cycle to periodic, giving administrators the latitude or the discretion to determine when certified staff should be formally evaluated or informally evaluated. Under induction contract teachers, induction contract teachers at one point, it was just one induction year. That has since changed since the policy was revised in 2008. So we're changing that wording to each induction year because now a teacher can have up to 3 years. Under annual contract teachers, we're changing individualized assistance plan, changing the words assistance plan to professional growth plan. And under continuing, a line was deleted to reflect the change, the first change that I've already noted. In the administrative rule, I know it was one word that was changed as far as annual, and I need to look at it, changing from annual to, you can only have four annual contracts, all certified staff. And I believe the previous policy said you could have five. It indicated five, but by law, you can only have four, so we changed that.
Any other questions or discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the superintendent's recommendation that the board approve the revisions to policy GCOA, administrative rule GCOAR, signify by raising of the right hand. Seven, thank you.
Madam Chair, if I may, before we leave human resources, I want to commend them for hiring one of our local people in one of those positions, but also express concern that I'm still getting phone, well, not still, but I'm getting phone calls from people who applied for jobs in the county that are qualified who are not getting, not even an interview, and particularly depending on who they put down for reference. So I just want to caution us that we need to be fair to everybody.
Thank you. Under the next to the board chair report, the update I know that y'all are getting on email as well as the Ethics Commission deadline for the Statement of Economic Interest. I have recently paid my fine from 2011. Not ashamed of that, but I filed it in November and didn't do it before April, so that was it was not an appealable issue, so I wrote the check. So don't, and I went ahead and filed it for this year at the same time. So I know that we've all had those hiccups. Yes. So no, don't overlook that. It might get down the road 2 or 3 years, but they still catch up with you. And I hear that there are others that to which that has happened. So this April 1st, I believe, March 30th. Yes, I thought it was April 15th as well, but I think it's March 30th. I continue to get emails even though I have filed it, so I have double checked that they had. And the check cleared.
I never get emails.
I got one.
Yeah, I got the emails. To the next one, the board travel report, the board members will be attending the South Carolina School Board Association annual convention this week, later this week, beginning on Wednesday. And Mr. Green and I will be presenting on Thursday at 10:15 to around 11. Bernie, one of our legal counsel, is presenting prior to us. So hopefully he gets the crowd excited and ready to ask questions prior to ours. So pleased to announce that. I think Mr. Cunningham, Mr. Green, and I are going on Wednesday. The other board members on Thursday will stay until Sunday. The closing session, I think, is over at 11. Last year, the closing session was well worth the attending of it. I was sleepy and tired, ready to go home, but I was glad to have attended that session, and I've been parking back in my car in ever since. I think, Ms. McDaniel, you and I looked at each other, but we remember that was it, he was an NFL referee, and he said one thing that he learned by being an NFL referee was that his daddy told him always back your car in, and he thought that was probably the biggest message that he could apply to school board members as well. So I think I took that to heart, and I'm going to say that ever since I've actually backed my car in. Sometimes you have to get out a little quicker than others. So, So anyway, we'll be in Myrtle Beach, and I know that the National School Board Association conference is in New Orleans in April, and we've got several members attending there. So that's it. Yes, ma'am.
Can you put me on the agenda for this so I can give you a report on it?
You don't want to do it now? Just wait.
Absolutely.
Okay, we got you.
Thanks.
Under that, we will adjourn. We have a motion. Thank you. Got a second from Ms. Harrison or somebody over there. All in favor signify by raising of the right hand. Thank you. Y'all have safe travels.